This is a very good moment to introduce our keynote speaker. So Arif van Bennekom, as I discussed with him briefly, very few of you know that he started his careers in the healthcare, delivering babies. I'm sure he can elaborate on that more. Today, Ari is delivering agile know-how through his vast experience as an Agile Manifesto signatory.
He focuses on the real fundamentals of Agile. So we invited him to introduce us with symptoms of successful and unsuccessful Agile transformation. Please give warm welcome to Ari van Bennekom.
This one. Okay. So, good morning.
Morning.
Okay. Already? Yay. Okay. Who wants to know why I delivered babies? It's true, right? It's not a makeup, but it's always like, oh, this is interesting because it's so different from the average. Okay. Let me tell you a little bit about it. And it's also a story of why I'm here. Very simple. It's very loud. Maybe you can do it a little bit softer. In the Netherlands, when you go to high school at the age of 15, my high school was officially to be stopped at 18. You know, you finish at 18 and then you go to university. And when you're like, you know, third or fourth class, 15, 16, the schools organize all those sessions where you can meet, you know, you can meet other universities, military, and et cetera, and you can try to find out, you know, what it is that you want, as if you know at the age of 15 what you want to do the rest of your life. I think in the Netherlands, the average of people that really end their career where they started their education is 10% only. 10% only. And I remember my mother was a traditional Dutch mother, you know, started her working life in the elderly care. When she got children, she stopped working. So when I came home at the age of 15, you know, from school, the bicycle for half an hour, she would wait for me with tea and cookies. And you explain, and she would always ask me, do you have homework? And I would say, no, I don't have homework. Like that kind of. But I was, you know, somewhere like 15. And I said, Mom, you know, we had one of those excursions today, and I know what I want to do when I want to, I'm a big boy. He said, okay, what is it that you want? I want to deliver babies. I want to become a midwife. And in the Netherlands, being a midwife was and still is a job for, now I would say 95% women only. And I think it's everywhere in the world where you go, right? I see ladies doing this now. Guys are looking like this. Okay, so, and what I liked, I love my mother a lot, as you can imagine. But what I liked so much about her, she didn't debate because, you know, traditional, it would have been technology or something. And she said, well, son, if that's what you want to do, that's what you got to do, right? So that's what I did for a while. And then I thought, no. That's not what I'm going to do for the rest of, very hierarchical. And the job of a midwife was being somewhere in a little village, somewhere in the Netherlands, and working 365 days a year on your own. And I thought, no, that's not the model. Otherwise, it's in the hospital, full hierarchy. And I saw things because it was 2 weeks working, 2 weeks school, 2 weeks working, you know, all year long. And I saw things going wrong because of hierarchy, and seriously wrong. So I thought, no, not my job. And I strongly believe in you're the architect of your own life. My book is about to be published, and it's not about the Agile. That's the title. You're the architect of your own life. And if you're somewhere where you think things can be done differently, can be do better, or you don't like it, you have a couple of choices. One, you accept it. Two, you change it. Three, you leave. Don't start complaining. And I see so many people, they're in the same company for 25 years, and then you sit down, so you're in the pub, right? You drink a beer, and then they will tell them such a horrible company, and their boss is an asshole for the last 12 years. And then I ask them, why are you working there, right, for 25 years? And they look at you like it's like they have no people sit. I'm not like this. So I stopped my education program, and in the Netherlands at the time, if you had your education program, next step was going into the army. So when I stopped, I had to go into the army. And there was a funny story about this. So I had to be a platoon commander at the infantry. So you go into training for 6 months. And at the end of the 6 months, you know, you get all those tests and stuff, and you pass, and you get your stars, and you become a platoon commander. And we're celebrating, right? Everybody's drinking beers. Oh, I got my stars, and you know, that kind of thing. And then my drill sergeant came to me, and he said, Von Menicum, you know, they call you by your last name, right? Von Menicum, you're not going to make it in operations. I said, this is odd, right? Because if I'm correct, you just passed me, right? You gave me my stars, and now you're telling me I'm not going to make it. I said, why? He said, you're doing it differently. Okay. You know, if you have, you know, the manual, how to be a soldier, you always have it with you in the Netherlands. It's over here. And if you do it differently, obviously, there's a concern. I strongly believe you're the architect of your own life. I remember when I got into the army on day one or day two, we had a drill sergeants, a number of them, and then one education platoons commander, a Lieutenant Rose, I'll never forget his name. And he was like, this is a big guy, massive, very short, blonde hair, as you can imagine, right? It looks like, and he said, so it was in May, you know, where we had to come, and it was about for 16 months. And he said, who of you booked a summer holiday? And a lot of people raised their hand. They said, well, you're going to forget about this one, right? Because you're in the army now. And I didn't raise my hand. I thought, there's something behind this question. I'm not going to raise my hand here. And guess what? I went on summer holiday, Canary Islands. You're the architect of your own life, right? I think you can do this. I just went one level up. I said, you have a problem. He said, why? Where's the major? He said, why? He said, well, I cost you money. He said, why? Well, I have this you know, contract signed for my holiday. And if I cannot, you know, cancel the holiday because of this, so you have to pay for it. Okay, you go on holiday. That's seriously what happened, right? You are the architect of your own life. Who of you is an agile coach? Humanity, we do agile transformations. I travel the world. I do talks like this, and sometimes small masterclasses, big conferences, and then we have sometimes requests from companies like Motorola or other companies that say, "Hey, can you help us do an agile transformation?" Of course. And then people apply for jobs because they want to be an agile coach. And I asked, why in the world do you want to be an agile coach? Because if you're an agile coach, after a while, if you're a good agile coach, people don't like you anymore. Because where you say, oh, no, this doesn't work here because of our culture, then a real agile coach will say, oh, yes, it does. And he gives you a notch out of the door, right? That's what's supposed to happen. And this is what I would like to talk with you about, because also as an agile coach, you're the architect of your own life. And not everybody realizes this. One of my coaches from the Netherlands was doing a job in Paris. And he gave me one of those whining calls. Yeah, no, but they treat me as a traditional project manager. I said, what the fuck? You are a coach, right? Coach them in a different way. Oh, yeah, that was a good idea. It's like, come on. It requires something to be an agile coach. It requires knowledge, it requires skills, of course, experience, and I want to take you on this journey, okay? I am very happy. If you want to ask questions, just ask questions. I promise to stay here today, so in between breaks, you can ask questions as well, right? So if you raise your hand, it's not that dangerous, okay? Agile now what? I was in Moscow 2 weeks ago, and there was a crisis meeting with a client of mine. And he said, Ari, your agile coaches are doing a basic agile. And we are doing it for 2 years now. We are advanced. Right, so I have a little bit of a concern here. And then I just asked, how many deliveries do you have? What's your frequency of delivery? And then the most painful questions, do you have end-to-end delivery teams? No, they were doing, this is not a joke, sprint for analysis, and then they would do a sprint for design, and they would do a sprint for development, then they would have test, and then they would have UAT, right? Why do we do agile? Why? Honest question, no exam, just a question. Why do we do agile? One very simple line, to avoid delay, period. And everything that you see causing delay, you take it out. You mentioned the word efficiency, right? One of the things in Agile, in the manifesto, is about, Scrum is about efficiency. That's not my line, it's Jeff Sutherland's line. It's about efficiency, right? Good. So I want to talk with you about this and look, okay, how can we avoid delay? And then, okay, so here it is, 1987. I go into the world of IT, I become a developer. And in 1994, I'm doing a project. This is internal only, we don't publish it on the web, right? Just checking out, are we going to publish one on the web? Because it's about the Dutch IRS, the tax office. I was, and they're famous for doing things wrong. And they're always in the newspapers. And what happened in my case, it is 1993, in November, we start a project. I was part of a technical design team, three people. And we were doing like this, like I just said, you know, we had really like analysis, functional design, technical design, development, test, UAT, pre-product, what the fuck is pre-product? And then, okay, we're going to production. I don't know what it was. And we are working there with 30 people, big project team. And after 7 months of full-time working with 30 people, this is like 8:15, I walk into my little room with the two other technical designers. 10, someone comes into the room and says, you have time for a meeting, we have a meeting with all the team. 10:15, everybody was out. Project canceled. So how in the world can you, and never start it again, how in the world can you start a project, work on it for 7 months with 30 people full time, stop it and not even start it again? So we did something for 7 months that wasn't even needed with public money. And this is where it started being different again for me, like, you know, you're the architect of your own life. You make choices, right? And at the end of my military time, my company commander said to me, today, if you want to, I can write you a letter of recommendation for the military academy. And I thought, oh, I would have been retired by now, because in the Netherlands, I'm 55 out. Right? I thought, okay, cool, could do that. No, I don't. Because it's not what I want to do the rest of my life. And I make the choice what I want to do the rest of my life. And then it's 1994, and this happens. And it was really like this. I had a black Nissan Primera, I know, company car. And at the, you know, the ground floor of the building, I'm standing next to my car. I said, what am I going to do now? You know, we wasted just massive millions of public money. And not happy because I was doing technical design. And I think that the developer here could read the functional design here. So my added value of my daily work was approximately zero. I thought, no. So I went to the office, we had six managers, and I spoke before lunchtime, five of them, and I said, and this is what I'm not going to do anymore. And I don't know what I want to do because I don't know what's out there. And I thought, you know, if they fire me, I'll find a solution. But then they fired me. I just don't want to do this anymore. One of them gave me a call very shortly after. He said, I've got something for you. We are going to do a pilot with the Royal Navy about rapid application development. Who of you knows rapid application development or heard about it? Not an exam. Yeah, you can raise your hand. It's okay, right? I see people doing this always. And you're like, I think, okay, what does it mean? I don't know. Or okay, I see some hands going up, right? Okay. Rapid application development is talking about business participation, workshops, iterations, increments, prototyping. Really interesting. And I always say this is where the experimenting started. Development, we talked improvement, or continuous improvement. Development is not something that you do by doing a training once or twice a year. It's a continuous process of teams and individuals, right? That's what we did together. That's where you go. So it's 1994. I start doing this pilot, and I remember about the military again. It said in the book, you know, when you're in a workshop, joint application design or joint requirements planning workshops, everybody's equal. This is the military, right? So we had people from the military in the workshop. One was, we call it in the Netherlands, captain on sea, which is basically, you know, commander of a boat. And we had corporals. And there's the captain on sea and the corporal sitting next to him. He looked at him and he said, corporal, yes, sir. Today we are equal. Yes, sir. That worked. That is amazing. Amazing. Right? And then this is one of the things. When can you let go of hierarchy, right? This is the kind of, when you empower people, when you put people in their strength. Experimenting started, and I can tell you things went brilliantly. Of course, nothing went wrong. Awesome. The first week. And then things were getting difficult because how do you do this? How do you get there? The success then, because it was a successful project, the success then was the very, very close collaboration of people from the business, whatever the business is, and the developers, whatever the developers develop. Right? I mean, we can talk IT, but the marketing department making a marketing campaign is also a development team. Or an HR team doing a recruitment campaign is also a development team, right? So we have developers and we have the business. But what I also started doing very shortly after is, okay, you know, I have here developers, and then I have over here, I have the business, and they talk together. But when I'm about to go live, then somebody will say, we didn't check it. So you cannot go live before we check it. Okay, who are you? We are from the marketing department. We are from the operations department. We are from the architect department. We're from the legal department. And we are from the communication department. They all had a say. And it was organized like this in most companies. So this is 1994, 1995. So I managed to overcome this one as well. And I want to take you on that journey and how to make that change, because I started doing projects in a successful way. In an organization where projects go wrong, all of a sudden, happy client, on time, in budget. So you do three projects, happy client, on time, in budget, in the same company. And then the fourth project that you want to do, say, no, we're not going to work like you, because it's so complicated. And I don't think it's complicated. This is when we were in Salt Lake City writing the Agile Manifesto, you know, one of those signs like we have here outside the door that says what the meeting is all about, right, in the conference center. Horrible picture, as you can see, but it was the Aspen Room. And it was a lightweight method. The point is, if you do lightweight, it doesn't mean that we can do whatever we like. We are still, you know, even if we are working in small teams, sometimes you're in a bigger group. You do things with 100 people or with 1,500 people. I was in a program in Moscow with 1,500 people. And they have to work together because it's one big solution at the moment, right? So you have dependencies. How do you fix it? But still, in the way of working. And for me, this meant, you know, when I was doing this, you know, and when I was doing my last project, it really looked like this, right? It was, as I said, very traditional waterfall. And what the point was, is here was a group of people, let's say it was analysis, and they made a document because they talked to, this is the magic that you talked about, the client, right? All of a sudden we talked to the client. But then the analyst, he made a document. And he would give the document to the functional designer. He would make another document out of it. And give it to the technical designer, another document. And give it to a developer. I was in mid-1993 doing a project at a chemical company called DuPont. And the manager of the IT department was looking at a very big document. And she was not looking happy. I said, what's going on? She said, Ari, this was this document. And said, Ari, listen. It was Friday morning, 11, we had a coffee. She said, Monday, I have a meeting at 10 and I have to say whether it's right or wrong. She said, first of all, it's too much. Second, I don't understand what's in there. Data models, functional input processes, functional output processes. She said, I don't know. And then she said magical words. I can ask my IT department, but the IT department doesn't know what my people do. And this is the real cool thing. Agile, if you want to have a one-liner, is about information at the source. And you want to know why? It's very simple. You are making assumptions and interpretations based on what I say now, right now. Everybody is making interpretations and assumptions right now. And everybody's interpretations and assumptions are different. And everybody's interpretations and assumptions are wrong. You can be close to the truth, right? But if I have to make something for you, and if I make interpretations of your words, I'm wrong. So I have to check, I have to validate. And if I do this based on a paper process, it doesn't work. It's about, you know, efficient, avoiding delay. If I do a paper process, it doesn't work. And I see still so many teams, agile teams, that work with agile flows, with paper flows. Because if it works like this, I make a document, takes me a couple of days, send it to you, you're busy. You're always busy, right? See, he's busy. So it takes 1-2 days, he sees my mail, but takes 1-3 days to find time to read it. Then you take time to read it, and then we get the magic. MS Word, track changes, you know it? Colored in red, preferably. And then he starts making notes in the document. And he sends it back to me after a day, four, five. I'm busy, so it takes another 2 days. And I might make interpretations of his written changes and notes. I stack my mistakes on his mistakes. And it's not because we're dumb people. This is a human process that doesn't work. If we are sitting at the table and we just ask to validate our interpretations, it takes seconds instead of days or weeks, right? So this process was not working. So this process, ladies and gentlemen, is still not working. It doesn't mean that we don't document, but we find a way to do things differently, right? Lightweight, that's what you want to do. All the activities are in there, but in a different way. You have to analyze, you have to design, you have to make lines of code, you have to do tests, of course. But not in, someone said, yeah, but Agile is about mini waterfalls. No, it's not. Maybe for the next conference, James Grinning, test-driven development. Awesome talk, how we can test from the beginning of the process. Maybe you already do, I don't know. Awesome, right, he's great. Who of you in the past, like 2001 maybe, like 20 years ago more or less, had a Nokia phone? Who of you? Who of you still has a Nokia phone? You're a hero, man. You're a hero. You're there. You're a hero, yeah. Why do I ask you this? In 2001, I had a Nokia, and Nokia was awesome, right? Good battery power, and you could play Snake, of course, right? It's awesome. The point is, there were leaders in the world at that moment in time. 2-3 years later, I don't know exactly the year anymore, they were almost wiped from the face of the earth, and everybody will say, yeah, my BlackBerry. Remember the BlackBerry with the trackball? I thought the trackball was amazing. Did you ever use it, the trackball? Oh, if you're from the touchscreen generation, you don't know, right? But the trackball was an improvement, it was amazing. What happened was that it was not just a trackball, it was not BlackBerry, it was the introduction of the smartphone into the world, right? Where in 2001, the phones were basically normal cell phones, in, you know, the change to smartphones. And here it comes. They told me, and I trust this one, I trust the source, but I didn't check myself at the board of Nokia. But they had Nokia smartphones on the shelf, ready for the market. They just didn't put them on the market because they did not want to cannibalize on their own product. And I said, oh, don't worry, BlackBerry did, right? Instantly. Agility is about being able to respond to change. And if you want to deliver, you know, without any kind of delay, and if you're faster than we did in the past, you cannot allow this kind of, you know, mistakes, because they are painful. And Nokia is just one. I can talk about Kodak, I can talk about KPN, I can talk about TomTom. You know, you have to respond. Agility is a corporate capability to change, to respond to change. That's what it is. It's not doing sprints in a software development team. That's not being agile. It's a corporate capability to respond to change. Because the only thing that we want to do is we want to deliver value to the market as soon as possible with the best internal quality. That's what we want, whatever we do. And the world today is dominated by technology. And I have this slide for a while now, and for many years, and I just keep it there. And you know why? Technology is going faster and faster and faster, the innovation, and it will never slow down. It will never go slower in the future, only faster. This means that while you are doing things, new opportunities are open. That's why you need agility. That's where you need the response. Nowhere else, right? And also because it's going so fast, we have very short product life cycles. So it's a very different thing about designing something that needs to last forever, or say, okay, I have something, a product that's going to be on the market for a year or maybe two, because very often this happens. I'm already looking forward to January because I have the new iPhone, right? And my contract is ending, so it's 2 years. And I know there are quite a few people that have maybe mobile devices for half a year and they switch to the new one. Right? This is what technology, and it's not about the mobile device, it's about the opportunities that mobile devices give. And now we get to the real pain point, no, maybe not the pain point, but the challenge and also the opportunity. What technology does these days, it disrupts business models. It makes business models obsolete all of a sudden, It doesn't work. Cell phones don't work anymore. TomTom, navigations, no needed anymore because they're in your phone, right? And new things can happen. Banking changed over the last 25 years, 3-4 times in the business model. Telcos changed 3-4 times in their business model. And I was talking to a gentleman of the board late last year. And I said to him, 2024, you have no clue what your business model will be. And he looked at me and said, Ari, 2020, I don't know. And it's not because he's a dumbass. It's because he understands what's going to happen. I like to make a metaphor. I was sailing the North Sea once. A couple of years ago with a group of friends. And, North Sea, Netherlands, Belgium, and then you go to the south of England. And we're in the harbor Friday evening. We got in like 11, and quick shower. And in the meanwhile, the skipper was, designing on the map the path, how to sail, taking in consideration the wind, the current, the tide, to get to Normandy. He said, Saturday evening, 8 o'clock, we will have dinner in Cherbourg Harbor in Normandy. Okay. So that was the sailing objective. Cherbourg Harbor, dinner at 8. That was the one. So we leave. I think it was like 2 in the night or something. And I took the first watch with my friend Johan. He's a Swiss guy, awesome in sailing. Can you see the logic? Sailing, Switzerland? No, that's no logic. There are mountains over there. Well, okay, nevertheless, he's very good at sailing. And we took the first watch. So you're like 2 to 6 or something. I don't know. So you go to bed and you come back on deck like 9 or 10. I don't know exactly the time. And guess what? The wind dropped. If you're on a sailing boat, pretty important to have wind, right? Now, what you can do is, the skipper, he set the requirements knowing the wind, the current at the time that he made it to get there. Can you imagine what it would have, what the impact would be if on the middle of the sea, he would have written a request for change, send it to the change advisory board, right, and make sure that, and then you get it, by the time that you have your change back, approved or not, you're in Norway, right, not in France. So the capability that we need is to have by companies, management teams, excos, setting the way to go, the value to achieve, and from there on, getting people together who know the requirements to get there, the criteria for the requirements, like the legal, the operations, and the architecture department, and the people who can make it. This is what agility is all about, right? And then we get short time to, and point is, even today, this is what happens. I see so many people working agile in teams, and then the client is not happy. And the worst one is, the product owner kept, initiating new sprints, because I thought, this is odd. This is the product owner talking to the team every single day. Something goes wrong. Second one is hindering errors. How come? Now, the point is, in this model, we know, right? Because if you are here, you're doing a test, right? And here, the client will ask, when is it finished? And you think, I don't know. Now, what does it cost? I don't know. I want to know. January 1. Okay, January 1. Okay, good. So, January 1. So, you can see, and you take a month for design and 6 weeks for technical design, but it's not a month, it's 5 weeks, and the 6 is eventually 7, so 4 to 5, and 5 to 7, and this is from 2 months to 3 months. So, and the deadline stays here. And we know that the one thing that you do at the end is in trouble, because then you do a little bit less of what you do need to do at the end, and then you're on time. I've been in a situation where a QA manager said to me, and this was you know what QA means? Yeah, who said it, the last word? Assurance, yeah. You know what assurance means? I guarantee the quality here. That's what it says, yeah? And she said to me, Ari, there was so much pressure from the business. We went live without testing. This is a quote and not a joke. But how does it work? Push, 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 push. So if I have an activity that I always do at the end, that activity is always under pressure. And I see still so many people in the sprint doing all the tests at the end. Or even worse, the demo is an acceptance meeting. It's what is the disadvantage of an acceptance meeting? Oh, come on, this is not rocket science. What is the disadvantage of an acceptance meeting? That people don't accept, right? That's what happens. And if people see something for the first time, what will they say? It's new for me, I don't accept. Right? So this is where we go. So we have a problem if you do it like this all the time. So what you see is we have a lot of, if we can go back to the slides again, we have a lot of hindering errors at the end, you know, when, because we don't test, and we know how to test, but we don't, right? And then we go over budget and over time because we say, okay, we have an extra change and we have an extra change and there's a new idea and there's a better idea and we just do it on top of everything else, right? Or worst case, a change advisory board full of managers who have no clue about the solution and the value, they will decide if you get a detailed requirement or not. It doesn't work. Now the point is, next one, if you deliver something else than the business needs, you didn't, I like to keep things simple, okay? You didn't talk properly. If you are the budget owner and you want food, you want me to get food, I come home with the wrong stuff, we didn't talk properly. That's not complicated, or I'm an asshole. Also an option, of course, right? I do the things in the wrong way. But 9 out of 10, we didn't communicate well because I have good intentions. So I'm walking around the supermarket, oh, I think he needs this, oh, I think, don't think for some, you cannot think for someone else. Never, right? We know how to make good stuff, but this, like the quote from the lady QA manager, right? This is the problem. We know how to do it, but under pressure, we do things different way, right? So, okay, problem. And of course, efficiency. Efficiency, oh, if you do a little bit like 10% more and you get really the good stuff, not a problem. The average IT project, the latest statistic I have is from 2014 in the Netherlands. The latest statistic was that the average IT project is closed at 189% of the original budget. That's, let's say, more or less times two. And this is odd. You know, you worked all your life hard, you have $500,000 to spend, and you finally are green grass, you build yourself a home. You have your contractor, and he says, okay, November, you know, 250K, it's there. And then all of a sudden, you know, he said, oh yeah, when he delivers January 1, obviously, because it's too late. And then you have 250K, it's 425. You're not going to pay this. And you don't know this at the end, you know. This is what's going on, right? Last year in March 2018, a Dutch governmental organization, 2,200 employees, they filed a budget at the national government for 36 million euros to build a new software solution. You know how many years that is of software, you know, to make a software solution? 720 man years or something like this. I made a calculation. Then half a year later in the autumn of 2018, they said, oh, sorry, we made a mistake about the budget. It's not 36 million, it's 95 million euros. Oh, right. And then in March 2019, they said, you know, we need an extra 25 million euros extra. And then somebody pulled the plug in the government, finally. Things go wrong. So, and the last one is the most important one. And this one is because of technology innovation speeding up. I spent half my life on airports. I order everything online. Dishwashers, washing machines, tumble dryers, the pomade for my boxer shorts, my socks, I order everything online. So you Google, right? You know what the best place is to hide in this world? Page 2 of Google. Nobody will find, everybody selects from page 1, right? So you go on Google, you sit there, and this is how it works. So I, you know, Björn Borg boxer shorts, right? Oh, sorry, unknown boxer shorts. And you go there, and you start filling the basket, or you want to do the payment, and if it's not working, swipe left, next. You have about 10 seconds. It has to be good. The time where we could have massive, you know, problems and bugs in software solutions is past tense, right? We cannot do this anymore. Now, then we have the digital. That's what I was just talking about, right? And then we go. There we go. The last bullet is here, the most important one. We want to avoid delay. And we have delay because we don't understand each other well. We communicate remote and written. Another one-liner, agile is about face-to-face communication, not remote and written communication. So the moment you start communicating via emails and documents, you know you're doing the wrong thing, right? And you can also correct your fellow colleagues on it, right? So first of all, it's a misunderstanding, because if I have a misunderstanding and if I deliver the wrong stuff, I have to do rework to make it the proper value. I lose time. The second one is, if I don't work properly and I have a lot of bugs, I have to do rework and I lose time. And efficiency is about losing time. So it's about avoiding delay. That was this one. Yeah, thank you. Maybe you could already draw the conclusion based on my talk so far. Agile is interaction. If you expect a tech talk, I am so sorry. And technology is very important. Don't get me wrong. If you go into an agile transformation and you're going to work agile and you have to do 2-week delivery sprints and you want to deliver every 2 weeks, you need to have automated testing, you need to have your integration, you need to have your deployment. Everything needs to be in place. You cannot do this by hand anymore. You know, IT is like the doctor is sick. You know, we automate someone else's job and we keep on doing our own jobs manually, right? So you need to get in. And this is weeks ago that someone said to me, "Hey, Arie, I heard you talk, really interesting. But you know about this automated testing? Did you ever see it work in a company? Because I only know there's a lot of money spent on it." I said, "Yeah, I saw it work 15 years ago already." You have to keep on finding, searching, innovating, looking, trying, right, to get there. But it's an interaction concept. And once you have the interaction going, someone asked me just, I don't know where you are now. I saw it. You had a talk this morning very early. How do you get the business people in? I want to give you a story later on about the interaction and who is going to be in that process. The right people. And let me give you one word. You know, the first type of workshops that we have, don't talk meetings, workshop, is about the content of the solution. What does it do? One of my clients said, "Okay, Ari, the number of SLA overruns has to go down by, I think in his case, the number of SLA had to go down by 80%. That was his, okay, so we make a solution that helps him. We have a problem that we can see the SLAs earlier and we can fix it with our clients. Okay, good. That's a value statement. So I said to him, "Give me your people who are in this process. You know, when you have a problem," there's a network organization. "If you have a problem in the network, give me those people. When you have a distortion or a disruption in your network, who are handling this situation, give me those people in workshops, and they will tell me where the problem is. They will tell me why they have an SLA overrun and not able, you know, within the SLA time to fix it." I said, "Oh, give me those people." "Oh, good, okay, that's good." But that's not the only group, because in this company, I had a legal department, I had a marketing department, I had a communication department, and I had a department of education and training, because they would make training materials based on the new solutions. Before go live, they would say, "I have to approve this." So a stakeholder is any kind of department, I'm not talking individual, but any kind of department that down this line can say to the team, yes or no. And this is important. It's not just the business, or even worse, someone who is representing the business. The worst version, if you are a product owner from the IT department representing a business department, then you are really screwed. Because you're getting in between, right? And that's what you don't want to be. You want to have, the development team has to get information at the source to validate and to verify. Validate, do I understand you well? Verify, is this what you really need to get to France, you know, and to be to have dinner at 8 o'clock on Saturday evening in Cherbourg Harbor? Because you can do a lot of things on a boat, but you need to do the right things. The second one is on the program. I meet people, who of you is doing it daily? On a daily basis, by the way. Who of you is doing it daily on a daily basis? Okay, quite a few. I meet people and say, you know, we are so busy, we do the daily once a week. And this is a quote. It's not just one off, right? Why? They don't understand why we do it daily. Why are we doing it daily? Not an exam. Why are we doing it daily? Come on, why? To align, absolutely. Align on what? What we have done and what we are going to do. And? And change the plan. So it's about what have you achieved yesterday, what are you going to achieve today per individual, so we know who's working on what. And do you have an impediment, right? It has nothing to do with the daily. The daily is I take requirements into a 2-week sprint, and I'm going to develop and deliver them at the end of 2 weeks. Where am I in this process, right? That's where I am. It's not about the plan. It's about those requirements. Yeah, for me, it's very stupid to say it. I don't know if we're on the same page or not. But I want to explain to you why. I had the example of my younger son. He loves studying, not so much. And I'm divorced, so when he's now 23, right? But when he was 16, high school exams. And then every week on Thursday, he would come to home. And we have dinner. My older son as well, of course, three of us having dinner. So, hey, high school exams. Any trouble? They're in May, late May, early June in the Netherlands. Are you okay? Yeah, he'll say, yeah, I'm okay. And that's what you want to hear as a father, right? That your son says, I'm okay. I thought, you never know, right? So in February, hey, son, exams are coming up. Yeah, I'm okay. March, I'm okay. Second week of May, we had panic. They call it the student syndrome, but it's a human syndrome. If you have 40 hours to work on something, and after 7 hours, you think, whoa, this is complicated. You keep on struggling until, maybe day five or something. And then you might say, hey, I have an issue here. Can you maybe help? And then together as a team, we are late. Agile, another one-liner, is not about individual tasks. It's about team delivery. That's why we do it daily. You cannot do without WIP limits. You cannot do without the definition of done. And the moment that someone has an impediment, someone in the team, I hope, will say, oh, I've seen that before. After the daily, I come to you and I can help you how to solve this one. And if not, the Scrum Master will take it out and say, okay, you go work on someone else. Take something else to work on. I will try to find someone who knows the answer. Right. But the point is, the daily is, of course, about alignment and understanding who worked on what. But it's especially on the impediments, knowing if someone is struggling, because Agile is about team delivery. And at the end of 2 weeks or 3 weeks, let's say 2 weeks sprint, at the end of 2 weeks, you deliver as a team. Everything that's hindering or threatening that one, you need to tackle it ASAP. You want to avoid delay, remember? And the focus is really interesting. So I see too many teams that don't have a value focus. Yeah, we're going into sprint. Oh, okay, what are you going to deliver? No, not the requirements. What is the value that you're going to deliver? They don't know. How in the world can you set priorities if you don't know what kind of value you need to focus on? You have no clue. I mean, sailing from the south of England to Normandy takes a day. So food is on the list, but on the low side. Keeping the sails in order is very important. That's the must have. That's where the value is. Right? You need to know. If the value would have been on the set that I just have good food wherever you are, then food would have gone up. I was the chef, so okay, I could cook a meal on board. Could eat in the middle of the ocean if you like. But that was not the plan. That was not the value that we're looking for. Right, so you need to, where are we? This young gentleman, people tend to look at what they want and not at what they need. So this happens if you go into a workshop. All stakeholders are there. I call them the heartbeats. Every 2-3 days, half an hour workshop. And then, it's like, okay, I have this new requirement here. Oh, it's interesting. And then I ask him, do you really need it? Yes. You know what the other answer is? Yes. Right? That's the only thing. Because people say, they say it because they think they absolutely need it. And what we often don't do in an all stakeholder session is quantify the value. Ask the very simple questions. How much, how many, how often? And then you get out, okay, this is what it brings. And if it comes to, bringing the number of SLA overruns down by 80%, this is how it contributes to that value. Okay, now we take it in, or we don't. Right? And that's not the PO says whether it's important or not. No, that's as a team sitting down and you say, this is really very complex. Okay, maybe I have an alternative. Not so brilliant, but does it help as well? This is why you need all people on the table. Why? because it avoids delay. Right? And we forget this. Who of you is working with WIP limits? Be proud. Be proud, really. Agile without WIP limits, impossible. If you don't have a definition of done, and if you don't have WIP limits, it's almost impossible to get predictable deliveries that are also with a good quality. So we have a new discipline. Agile is not about I can do whatever I like. I don't know where it came from, but as you heard now, I'm from the military, Jeff Sutherland's from the military, Ken Swaber's from the military, maybe more, I don't even know. But Agile is not I can do whatever I like. Agile is being very strict and very disciplined together. Agility means that I can choose in the morning what I'm going to work on with respect to our team working agreement. So if I have a WIP limit of 3 and 2 stories are open, I can open a third story. But if 3 stories are already open, I don't take the 4th story to open. I take something from story 1, 2, 3 that's still open, even if it's not the kind of work that I really like. That's discipline. That's agile. Because it's about stop starting and start finishing. And don't give me the bullshit bingo of I can do whatever I like. Right? It doesn't exist. So agile is about interaction. Right? Teams, stakeholders at the table. And once you have the interaction going, and it requires what you were just talking about, like decision making or those kind of changes, if you have this in place, and then you have the teams, then I can talk about technology. The point is, if I start working in a transformation on technology right away, people will only look at technology. And you know, a fool with a tool is still a fool. And so that's how simple it is. Right? So you need to talk about the mindset first. And the biggest problem that I see at the moment is the technology focus and also, you know, this one. Because this is the old school, right? We have business people, development people, and we talk like I wrote on the flip chart. We talk through documents. Doesn't work. Right? So we get a lot of misunderstandings. And then what we do is, because we have solutions from the past. We think, oh, this agile is new, never done it before. Oh, this is how I do it. And instead of putting a document in between, you put the PO in between. My God, you don't want to be a PO like this. Because the business, yeah, but I said this. And the business, no, you said that. No, yeah, but the PO is in the middle. Don't shoot the messenger. Yeah, we do all the time. Right? And the point is, if you work like it's really the same thing. Because I do via communication. And via communication is subject to interpretations and assumptions. So it's about getting people from the business at the table. Not someone who thinks he knows. When I was doing my career shift from Ernst & Young to another consultancy firm in 1991, one of the, we call him the field manager, you know, after my probationary time, he said to me, Ari, now you need to make a choice for a specialism. I was doing kicks, COBOL, DL1, DB2, and job control language. I thought, that's a specialism. He said, no, like finance or insurance or... How in the world, if I am working 40 hours a day in IT, making scripts and data models and lines of code, how can I be the specialist in somebody else's job? It's ridiculous. The only one who knows the job really is the person who does it every day. So that's the one you need at the table. Because if I have this via communication, I still have the delay. It's impossible if you have a delivery on the last day of your sprint that it's not accepted. It's impossible if you work agile. And it means if it happens that you have areas for improvement. Let me put it this way. Okay? You're never there. And the point is, we had a talk early this morning, like I said before, and he asked me, Anzi, where is he? He's gone. Toma, okay. Gone. Oh, there you are. Yeah, see. He said, okay, what kind of framework for, you know, for scaling agile would you like? I said, I never use a framework. Never do. And you know why? If I am using one framework only, I am only disabling myself. Why? When we wrote the Agile Manifesto, every one of us was working in a different way. So I started working differently in 1994, James Grenning in 1998, I don't know, maybe Jeff Sutherland in 1989, I don't know. But we all had years of working different from the waterfall for a very obvious reason. But every one of us had a different motivation to do it. So as I said, you know, spending public money, my focus was on value. Scrum focus is the efficiency. James Grinning, if you talk to him, he's 70 years old, he became 70 this year, I'm a software engineer. I want good quality lines of code, that's what I want. And James was looking at small teams, pairs, individuals, Scrum is, for example, focusing on teams, and I was doing large group, 20, 30, 50, 100 people. In small teams, working aligned on, like one product backlog. So I have one product backlog with elements for education and training, for elements for marketing communication, with elements for software delivery, for data conversion, for technical implementation, all working aligned. So big room sessions exist since 1995, at least, and maybe even before, I don't know, right? And the point is, where do you grasp from? So if you ask me, what kind of framework or method do you use? I don't use methods or frameworks. What I do is, I say, the umbrella is agile. That's the concept. People say to me, we use the agile methodology. I always think, great, that doesn't exist. Agile is a concept. The four values, the 12 principles, that's what it is. But every one of us had different ways. This is what we shared, but different ways of working. So what you see is, and I just made colors. Blue was before, when we were writing the manifesto, there were the black ones. The light green ones came after writing the manifesto, right? Don't get me wrong. So agile is the concept. And then we have the methods, and every method has a number of practices. And this is what you use when you are an agile practitioner. If you're in your agile team, you do a retrospective and you think, we have this problem, how can I solve? You don't look at the method, you look here. Which practice can help me? And I would like to invite you, if you invent a new practice, go on stage in a conference and share it, because that's what we did too, right? We're never done inventing new stuff. So this is where we are. This is my problem with coaches that don't even know that. I meet coaches that do not know there is more than one agile method. They don't know. An agile coach needs to know this. Because if an agile coach has a team with a problem, they say to the team, okay, what you can do in this situation? Here, this is the practice that you can use. That will help you. You need to know. You need to learn. I think the primary characteristic of an agile professional is you never reject other people's learnings. You listen and see what it can mean to you. Now, the big problem is, it's talking to each other. Come on, we can do this, right? So how come that the transformation is so difficult? I've been in a situation where I did the transformation, everything was working well. 2 years later, I come back. All the agile words are still there. And when what you know is that they work completely waterfall. Again. And you know why? It's very simple. Question. If you do something for the very first time, what happens? Yeah? Yeah? Now, it's not as brilliant as it could be, right? Go wrong or fail, or it's not perfect. Of course not. Managers expect if you do waterfall for 20 years, now we're going into an agile transformation, we're brilliant in one go. No, we're not. It's like, you're in the top league playing football. Now we're going to play hockey. Within 2 weeks, now we're playing top league hockey. No, you don't. That's going to take a while, right, to get there. And you might progress faster because you know how the sports work, but that's something else. These are paradigms. And what we need to do is we need to do paradigm changes. And when we do paradigm changes, enforced by a coach, because he will say, we do a daily, or we do a retro, or we do a visual management, that kind of thing. What happens, you try to make a step forward in the transformation process, and it doesn't go that brilliant, right? So what people will say, see, it doesn't work. And what they do is they grab a solution from the past and they step back. I call it innovating backward. You know who are the worst ones in this? And I can say this, frankly, I'm 55 myself. Guys over 50 with gray hair and a beard are the worst. If you meet them in a company, you think, oh my God, now I know where I am. They are the worst. Because they're in the paradigms for 25 years. That's their, if you look up in the Netherlands, at least the word paradigm in the vocabulary, it says it's a perception on how life is. So now you're going to change those old guys in perceiving the world. Are you over 50? Yeah? Oh, good, great. I thought you should. Okay, so I want to get back to the paradigms first. And there were simple ones. It's not a complete list, by the way. I just give you an identity crisis. Hey, I'm a senior business analyst in this company. I work here for 23 years now. And you're going to tell me that I have to test now? Is that what you say? Let me look at my job profile. No. No, it's not in there. This is what I experienced when in Paris. It's like, what the hell? Okay. It's a must. Managers that barge in. There's a team working, you know, focused in the barging in. They say, what are you doing? Yeah, but it's very important. I said, you just ruined, you know, a complete, you know, sprint. What are you doing here? Business people. I have those people, the business, real business people, but also from the legal and the marketing, the communication. I have them with me, right? And they say, I'm so busy, but you know what I want. I will say, no, I don't. And it's even worse, you don't know yourself. Because we're living in a complex world, we have complex solutions, and we need to be together to get aligned on the communication, and also, you know, to verify the value, because we are focusing on the value, not the delivery of a requirement. So those things are really, you know, and silo thinking, you know, it's all there. It's all there. I say, the most characteristic one, I was doing a transformation, and we had visual management in place with the full transformation backlog on the wall with the epics and the stories, and then we had the sprint backlog, and we had the burn down chart, and said to the client, two managing directors, I said, every 2 weeks at the end of a transformation sprint, you come here. We explain what we have done, and then we visit the teams. That's our demo. So in between, walk in anytime. So we did those. It worked like this. But then I noticed that the two managing directors took some other people with them, and my team was there, coaches. But there was someone there after every, on Friday, it was from 11 to 12, we had this demo. And then someone was sitting down behind the keyboard after this, typing like a maniac for 4 hours. And I thought, what? Then I asked one of the coaches, what is he doing? And he said, she's making a progress report. I said, what the hell? You know, we have it on the wall. We just spent an hour walking through the building explaining everything. If you wanted the progress report, photograph the bloody visuals on the wall, and you have your progress report. This is what paradigms do. You know why? It's not an MS Word, so it's not documentation. And that's what a paradigm is. Right? That's how stubborn they are. And I always, because I am not different from anybody else, right? So I always say to myself, if you come with me too, with a good idea, and I think, yeah, but that's the moment. Yeah, but that's the moment when an old paradigm is stepping on your shoulder. And I would like to invite every one of you, if your colleague has an idea, listen, try, experiment. If your colleague has a problem, don't deny it, accept it, and see how you can take it away. Right? That's what improving your team, because we don't do it for out of charity. We don't do it for love's sake. Yeah, I love you all, right? But it's about improving the business. That's why we do it, nothing else. And just some characteristics, end-to-end delivery. I see so many so-called agile teams that don't do end-to-end delivery. And I can imagine if you're in a transformation process, you're not there. I can understand, that's logical. But you have to keep on improving and transforming until you're there. And it can be done. I've worked in an agile factory in Belgium, absolutely brilliant. Stable, you know, solutions, awesome. Right? The heartbeats, where you have all those business, that was the question that you asked, right? Where you have not just the business, but also the stakeholders, and everyone who can say yes or no to what the team has made. And every 2 to 3 days, just show me what you've made, finished or not, I don't care. Show me what you've made. You give me the feedback. It's very little feedback. And I can adjust if needed, if valuable. And we decide together if it's valuable or not. Because if I get all the feedback at the end of the demo, I will have a no acceptance. And I have to do rework. And I'm late. I have a delay. The heartbeat is the most effective and efficient element to avoid delays. And then the management thing is about what you need to do. This is your team, right? And if you bring something in, in this team, you need to understand something has to go out. Because if you throw a stone in this bucket, what will happen, you think? what comes out, right? If you have a team that commits to 8 user stories and you bring in story 9 and 10, something will go out. And if you don't have a normal process to fix this, it's quality that goes out, instantly quality. You don't want to do this, right? And it's very simple, right? Because normally we would say, okay, we fix the requirements, and then we vary on time and on money, right? That's what we tend to do. We have a change, with a little bit of extra budget, a little bit extra time, and there we go. But honestly speaking, we never have enough money extra and enough time extra. It's always a little bit. So secretly what happens is that, you know, the quality in there will vary with it. So if we turn it around to say, okay, what we do is we fix time and we fix money, 2-week sprints. And we have requirements or user stories, I don't care how you call them. And we have a strong definition of done, and we respect WIP limits, then maybe we deliver a requirement less or more, but because we respect our definition of done, we also fix our quality. And it's so simple. It requires one thing, discipline. And that's what you need to understand, right? They call it the triple constraint. So we have now the upside down triple constraint. And I love saying it because it sounds so professional. Say, oh, I apply the upside down triple constraint theory. It's like, whoa, that's cool. Hey, can I have the slides back, please? So the bucket, something in, something out. And who decides on what's taken out? Who decides? Who said everyone? Who said it? Everyone. The business says, okay, you know, this is what value based, but it has to fit in. How complex is it? You know, how much time do we have left? Can we maybe find an alternative? So it's the team. And of course the business is leading. Of course. We do this. Totally right. But you do it together, because I can take something out, but it doesn't mean that you can make it on time. So I need you in there, right? Okay. Yeah. So the company is in chaos. Everything is late. We keep on stressing. And the only thing that managers do is they keep on pushing more cars on the bridge. So the role of agile leadership is about, how can I create a steady flow? How can I make sure that my teams can work in peace? Respect the agile rituals. Respect, you know, that the team has to decide on changes. And if you, I was once in a very big room, about 100 people working, so what is like 15 teams maybe, something like this. And the manager, and this is, you know, 350,000 people company, this is number 7, walking into the room. And I see 100 people looking at him, like this. And then he bends over to someone at the desk and he walks out. So I went after him. I said, what were you doing? He said, it's very important. I said, yeah, you ruined one full-time equivalent working week. Was it that important? He said, what do you mean? 100 people, you broke the concentration. It's 20 minutes to get your concentration back. But I bet they will check Facebook, go to the toilet, get a cup of coffee and talk about football for a while. So everybody will approximately miss 45 minutes. 100 people, there you go. I said, and it's very simple because you know for which team it was. Eh? Yeah. Give a call from your room, give a call to the Scrum Master, ask him to come to you, talk about it, see what the value is you think, and then in the next heartbeat, your Scrum Master will take it in, and then together, you work. And you have only one team extra in the heartbeat, and the rest of the people can work, right? That's what you need to do. You need to allow people to work on one project at the same time. Don't interrupt them all the time. Don't change it, you know, those kind of things. You don't change paradigms easily. It's a hell of a job. And to get your paradigms define reflexes under stress because something goes wrong. And what you do, you take something from your past, right? So they define your reflexes under stress. So we need to replace the reflexes under stress. Not easy. And you have to be strict in your transformation. Oh yeah, I'm an agile coach and I ask my team questions. No, you tell them what to do in the beginning. Now, if you go into this cycle, I call it the wave, you start with synchronizing. Because we were working like this, and now we're going to work like this. You need to know what it is. Okay, we played football, now we're going to play hockey. And if I don't pay attention, hockey has green field, white lines, 2 goals, and a white ball. And if I don't pay attention, people start playing football with a hockey ball. That's what will happen. So I need to be very strict. Rules of the game are different. That's how it works. Strictly in there. So the first two sprints in synchronize is 4 weeks. The first two sprints, so coaches take the teams. Every coach is like, in my case, we do four teams at the max. Because as a coach, you have four dailies, four retros, four, that's quite enough, you know, and then individual talks with people, that's a handful of work. And at the end of synchronize, people know the new rules of the game. But paradigms did not change. And in the second part, where you see follow, this is where the teams follow the coaches. So the coaches have a very directive coaching style. It's not about I can do whatever I like. No, no, this is how it works. And in synchronize, it's understanding the rules of the game, bits and pieces, getting the visual management in place. But then in follow, it's working as a team. So you have your backlog up and you know, your definition of done, and you know your poker estimates, and we have the visual management, and we are going to do it. And it's not going to be fast, but we're going to do it. And in the last 4 weeks here on lead, this is where the teams, they know it, they've done it now, and now they're going to work. It's like playing football. You know, they come to the new, like little ones, they come here. First, you're training with them, so they have the basics. Then you have the first games really playing. And then at one moment in time, on the side of the field, you can step back and say, okay, now they know what to do. But the point is, the individual people are changing from an individual task to team delivery. So being multidisciplined. So being able to, and this sort of a rule of thumbs that I always use, if you have a different definition of done of, let's say, 8 tasks, you need to be able to do at least 4 different tasks, preferably 5. Not all of them, but most of them. Because if you get stuck, I can help, and I get stuck, you can help me. That's the idea. Stop starting, start finishing. Team delivery. And then I take 1 week to sit down, okay, what do you need? Then the coach is going to take new teams, but on demand, the teams that have been in transformation can come back and ask, okay, well, what can I do? And in the meanwhile, to sustain the change, because the most difficult one is sustaining the change, is that number one, I build communities for knowledge share. Knowledge sharing is crucial. Knowledge sharing and learning is no longer, you know, doing 1 or 2 trainings a year and having a personal development plan. It's based on, you know, the need from a team and the need of the individual. Where do you want to go? You know, okay, I was a testing professional, but I also want to know more about, you know, development and coding. Great. And you're a coder. Said, okay, I want to know more about, you know, analysis and stories and story slicing. Great. Okay, what do you need to be able to do that for your team? Do you need training? Do you need a pairing up? What do you need? And then we make sure that it gets there, right? That's where we go. So the communities for knowledge sharing, because what you're looking for, somebody else knows, right? You bring them together. And also, as a company, it provides you a platform where you can have on those specific topics like integration or deployment or development or testing, the deepest knowledge from the market, because those people go to testing conferences or tooling or, and they bring it into the company. You asked this morning, what's the one-liner on successful agile transformation? What do you think? What's the one-liner on successful agile transformations? Yeah, no delay. Yeah, that's what you want to look for. What? What are we looking for? Absolutely. The most important group that needs the discipline. What's the most important group in the company that needs the discipline? Yes, the management. Because if a manager gives a traditional push, the team will give a traditional response. Right? So if you go into transformation, one of the things I like to say is this. Now, this is your company. So here is the top, and here are the teams working agile. This layer here, the middle management, is very important because they are most of the time responsible for the current silos. You're going into transformation, so they have to let go of a management position. And that's not an easy thing, right? The point is, the people here have so much knowledge about, you know, the professional domain, about the company, about the business, that once you have them in the transformation, you can make the best change agents ever out of them. If they want to, right? If they want to. If they not, they can block anything, and then I call them the permafrost. They block everything. Can I have my slides back, please? So So, and then people sometimes say, oh, don't give me the shit about the butterfly. And I say, okay, I can also do a frog if you like. But the point is, you're going to be really seriously different as an organization. The structure organized, the way you develop. And the talk we had this morning was about HR. Of course, HR is working agile themselves. If they go into recruitment campaigns, for example, but they have to understand agile, career paths, rewarding. You know, if you have individual targets and bonuses, it doesn't work in team delivery. So if you really want to be an agile company, you have to go away from individual targets and bonuses, that kind of thing. And then I was at the client site and I saw this one on the wall. And I thought, it's amazing. And if you read it, your perfection is not a state, it's an ambition. And to become perfect, you need to change a lot. So perfect people change a lot, right? There's something to say about it. It's not a state. It's not, okay, now I'm there. The mindset, okay, maybe. But this is, so scrum masters who do like this. I cannot understand why I need to learn because I know everything I do so like this for years. Seriously, manager of a group of scrum masters in front of me. It's a sanity, right? Improving is a way of life. So the mindset, the point is, you know, if you really get the mindset well, you know, from doing people that the things that people do are do well are the things that they like. So if you can build, you know, career development around people's ambitions instead of, you know, stereotype predefined roles, then you get somewhere, right? And that's what agile can help. So it's about doing agile is about, you know, being in front of a board at 8:30 in the morning. That's not agile. Being agile is understanding why it is and what it brings and why we do. And it's all in out, you know, getting with a high level of quality as fast as possible to delivering value. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ari. We really appreciate your talk. And
we have a small gift for you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you
very much. Ari, one comment from me, going back to what you said about the children at the beginning. I was looking for the...
We have a question, I'm sorry.
No, it's not a question, it's a comment.
Okay, sorry.
So you were mentioning the children at the beginning, and I was looking for some connection between the children that you wanted to take care of, you know, the development process and agility, and I found actually one. You know, it's going back to my speech about waterfall, you know, stages, et cetera, et cetera. Now we don't see it, but very often in the past, you know, people think that adding more people to the phase is going to speed up the development process. And it's exactly like, you know, mother in general is delivering a new life in approximately 9 months. And still, I think in the world, there are people that think that if you take 9 mothers, they can do it in 1 month.
Management teams especially think this.
So, yeah. You know, that just a comment, you know, that came into my mind. So never, I think.
No, but I totally align. It's like people expect magic. Things take time and you can take out the efficiency. Of course, it helps. That's maybe not in the metaphor, but we need to understand it's not magic, right? It's hard work. Yes?
Thanks again.